All right, everyone, thank you so much for coming. We're starting 5 minutes late, and unfortunately, our distinguished guest today is also leaving Boston tonight, and so unfortunately, we have to cut the total time of our presentation today a little bit short, but I'm sure that we will have a very productive and interesting conversation and the presentation of this wonderful book. Please allow me first to introduce our guest, who probably doesn't need much introduction, but nevertheless, Ola Hnatiuk. She is a professor at the University of Warsaw and at the Kyiv-Mohyla Academy, and she also served in the Polish Diplomatic Corps in 2006-2010. She is the recipient of numerous awards. So her book, Courage and Fear, was originally published in Polish in 2015 and in Ukrainian, and received several awards both in Ukraine and in Poland. Her other publications include such books as Between Literature and Politics, 2012, Polish-Ukrainian Dialogue, the journal Kultura and its Heritage, 2007, Farewell to the Empire, Ukrainian Discussions about Identity, 2005, and A Generation's Revolt, Conversations with Ukrainian Intellectuals, 2004. She is also a talented translator into Polish of works by Yuri Andruchowicz, Yuri Izdrek, and Mykola Rybczuk, and the editor of numerous publications in Polish and Ukrainian. For her achievements, she was conferred the Order of Polonia Restituta, as well as numerous other awards in recognition of her work, including the Antonowicz Foundation Award for Fostering Polish-Ukrainian Cultural Cooperation and the Pruszyński Polish Pen Club Award. Now, this book is the product of collaboration between various institutions, and we would like to acknowledge all of them here. We have a representative of the Collegium Europe Wschodniej with us, Lorena Spaciunas. We have also a representative of Academic Studies Press, Matthew Charlton, who were the co-partners of this publication, and which was also funded by the Polish Ministry of Science and Education. Let's just take a look. So today we want to talk more about this wonderful book, and maybe just to introduce it briefly, I'll read a few words by people who already responded to it, starting with our own Sergei Pluhy, who said, this is thoughtful, insightful, exceptionally well-researched, and moving at the same time. Courage and Fear is the book that plunges the reader into the depths of the history in one of the most contested places on the European map. Timothy Snyder, reviewing the book, said that Courage and Fear is much more than a memoir. What is novel here is the treatment of the sources as points of departure for the construction of individual lives and milieus, rather than for narratives about nations and institutions. The outcome is an image of Lviv that is frankly unsurpassed in its intellectual and emotional richness. And Sergei Zhadan, the prominent Ukrainian writer, responded as well, saying, considering how painful and not talked through questions from our very recent history remain for us, it is difficult to overestimate the importance of Ola Hnatiuk's work. It appears that we all, one way or another, will have to answer some very uncomfortable questions in the very near future. Books such as this one will make that a little easier. And I'm very pleased to turn over the floor to Ola Hnatiuk to introduce her book to us.
Thank you. Thank you for such kind presentation. I am terribly sorry, but I would like to add something because it is my great pleasure to be here. But I never forgot about my previous stay at Harvard. I was Schlar Fellow, and it was the best part of my life here. It was extremely, extremely nice experience and fruitful. So I would like to just thank you, Harvard Ukrainian Studies, and former director and current director, for such great days I have here and I have had here. And I never forgot about this. According to suggestions of Sergei Pluhy, I decided to focus on only on part of my book, which are women narratives. So the other part of book is not just men narratives, but the book is divided in seven chapters, and every chapter has the main hero and other heroes or protagonists are not so important, but still they play a significant role to be a kind of mirror of the main hero. That is a few words about construction of the book. The aim of the book was to tell the untold story. So to overcome master or grand narratives or national narratives, and to try to find a kind of solution of this rival national narratives, and try to see this history not from the top of the hill, but from the bottom. But that's why I decided to switch into micro history. And of special interest are women stories, because they were extremely suppressed. It is rather obvious that we are tend to produce heroic narratives to and these heroic war narratives are as a rule men narratives. After 2 years of work on translation, Eva Shivak, who is my sister, translated the book, and thanks to Collegium Europe Wschodniej and Academic Study Press and Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute, it appears just 3 days ago. probably earlier, but I saw the copy just on Monday. And I would like to start with the story with a well-known event, which was Ribbentrop-Molotov Treaty or Pact signed in August 1949, and some U.S. Caricatures from that time mean 24th, the day after the pact was signed, this pictures were published in U.S. newspapers. It is after that treaty, the War II began. The outbreak was obviously at 1st of September, when 17th of September, Soviet troops entered Polish territories, crossed the border, and occupied the half of interwar Polish territories, which were Western Ukraine and Western Belarus. Exactly the day after this entrance of the Soviet troops, my mother was born. And I am starting this book from this point of view, beginning from my family story, And it is important for me not only because it's my family story, but because I wanted to shorten the distance between me and reader and to show how it could work in other cases, in other family story. And the response for that I can't find the word for that way of introducing, of presenting my story was very well received by especially by Ukrainian readers, not as good. For Polish readers, but it was very well received by Ukrainian readers. So just very quick view for interwar Poland, which is red line, and the pink color is today's Poland borders, and the picture to the right as the cover of our exhibition presented in July 2010, when I still served in a diplomatic corps. We organized with my friends from Poland and from Ukraine the first open air exhibition. It was just next to City Hall, to on the front of City Hall at a square in Lviv, Market Square in Lviv. And it was a turning point for me because I started to gather material preparing for this exhibition, and then these materials exploded inside me. I couldn't leave the exhibition and not to forgot about it. I wanted to do something more than just exhibition, which presented different narratives, Polish narratives, and different representatives of Lviv Poles and of Lviv Ukrainians and of Lviv Jews. That's why I started to work on this book. And then I realized that I gathered some materials, some documents, but I started to work really intense during next few years, gathering these materials from very, very, sometimes very strange places, such as a medical library in Poland, in Warsaw, or other strange place was probably not very strange as a former KGB archive. It is rather obvious that I try to collect these materials, but as you can see, the book is based on very, very different sources. So a few more words about Lviv, how the face of the city changed during the last 70 or 80 years. The Polish census taken in 1931 showed that only 16% of inhabitants of Lviv were Ukrainians. And at the same time, in the region, it was a huge amount. It was the majority. The majority in the city, major inhabitants of the city were, of course, Poles, and 1/3 of inhabitants were Jews. And the situation in our region was, as I said, different. Then, after so-called liberation by Soviet troops in 1944, the situation has changed Ukrainians were more or less 25% in 1944. Obviously, Russians encroached, and Poles were more than 2/3%. And you obviously know that during Holocaust, the majority, not majority, almost 100% of Jews were killed, Jews from Lviv or refugees from other parts of Poland were killed in Lviv or near Lviv in Belzec during the Holocaust. In the 50s, the early 50s, the situation again changed, and the majority language in Lviv was Russian. And after de-Stalinization, the situation again changed, and the majority spoken language was Ukrainian. According to the census of 2001, more or less 88% of city inhabitants are Ukrainians. So it is just to explain how the situation and the not only situation, but how many tragedies happened during that time to civic inhabitants. And as I already said, rival master narratives of Ukrainians, Poles, and Jews about World War II are incompatible. I mean, the tendency is like that. Only we were heroes and others were at least enemies or even perpetrators. At the same time, within this master narrative, minor narratives exist. So there is a struggle between minority and majority narratives. However, master narratives is more or less the same features in different narratives. And it is not unusual situation just for Poles, Ukrainians, and Jews. It is rather typical for World War II, but they are different competitive narratives. At the Far East and at the West of Europe, it is relatively common. And what is beyond the story, untold stories, first of all, and this presented in my book are women's stories. Women narratives are rather hidden than told. I just listed some features of these master narratives. Maybe not all of them, but some of them. The first is probably ethnocentrism, not martyrology, but ethnocentrism, and then martyrology. And innocent victim, noble or lineally fight, and the focus on underground movement. It is the case of Poles and Ukrainians. I skipped with pictures because we have not enough time, just to present some very, very common, very popular. One of them was a film Liberation made by Aleksandra Dovzhenko. And when we compare this narration of propaganda of this film and his notes from his diary, it is a huge difference. It is completely other picture, other image. And it is part of Nazi image of Lviv, and some Lvivians greeting Nazi troops. And this picture was published in Lvivsky Vesti at the beginning of August. On the center is Hans Koch, and to his right is Yuri Polanski, and of course girls with embroidered blouses, vyshivanka. What was interesting for me in these unpublished documents, it is non-heroic narratives, a very personal approach to not the history, but the events, and not objective, rather subjective stories, but they have a huge range, many tints of gray color. It's not just a white and black division. So or division between friends and allies or and enemies. So what was forcibly marginalized or suppressed? First of all, women narratives. I will return to this sources a little bit later, probably, if our time will allow. Now I just wanted to give you a short strip through the book's chapter. As I said, the first chapter is devoted to my family story, a girl with a dog. This is the name of the portrait of my mother. Portrait painted by Ukrainian painter Yaroslava Muzika, who is a hero of the last chapter, artist from the Café de la Paix. The main protagonist of the second chapter is first woman hematologist in Lviv, Irena Lil. The main hero of the third chapter is a well-known Polish mathematicians of Jewish origin, Hugo Steinhaus. The main hero of the fourth chapter is Mikhailo Marchenko, who was a Ukrainian historian and educated in Institute of Red Professors in Kharkiv in mid-30s, and then at the beginning of World War II, he was imposed to Lviv University as a first Soviet and at the same time Ukrainian rector. When he entered university, he was the representative of Soviet administration, and of course Polish professor were against him and treated him as a Soviet Bolshevik and ugly guy. And when he was arrested in June 1941, he was arrested as a Ukrainian nationalist. So I am trying to tell what happened to him during this time, and how huge his impact was. For example, and it is very well known story about his grandson, Valery Marchenko, who was murdered in Gulag in 70s, beginning of 80s. So it is a story of changing mindset from Soviet one to Ukrainian, and it was enough reason to arrest Mikhailo Marchenko and to torture him. And this chapter is not only based on documents from interrogation, but also from other sources, many memoirs, entries, записи, diaries.
So entries or
entries in diaries. So it was probably not most difficult, but it was really difficult to show how it was. And at the same time, vice rector was Lviv professor, Ukrainian professor Kirilo Studensky, who also was a deputy of Supreme Council in 1940. Then he was in June 1941 arrested and killed, and we have no traces where he was murdered. So the story about Kirilo Studensky and cooperation with Mikhailo Marchenko is extremely interesting, because it is a story of changing mindset of both sides, the old Galician Ukrainian intelligentsia and new Soviet Bolshevik intelligentsia trained at the Institute of Red Professor in Kharkiv to be true Bolshevik and true Soviet. The fifth chapter is devoted to musicians who joined Anders' army, Polish general Anders' army, in 1941, but before they performance at Soviet stages all over European part of USSR. So it is a story about how artists, musicians were involved in this establishing Soviet rules. And I'm not using the word collaboration, as you probably noticed, because I'm really afraid of this word, because it's not me, collaborator, it's the guy who is my friend or is my enemy. I mean, the other is collaborator, never me. And it is typical attitude in many diaries, many, and especially in memoirs. Diaries are more correct in this, but in memoirs written, especially written after 50 years, this master narrative dominated of own testimony, own memory, and remove all other stories. The sixth chapter is devoted to writers and translators, and the main protagonist is Mykhailo Rudnitsky, who was born in a Ukrainian Jewish family. And he was the elder brother of the very famous in Galicia family, to name just the two the siblings, Milena Rudnitska and Ivan Kedrin Rudnitsky. He lived in the Lviv neighborhood during 1942, during Endlosung and early 1943. However, he translated during this time Hamlet into Ukrainian. And it was a premiere of Hamlet on the Ukrainian in Ukrainian on opera theater stage in September 1943, and it was for me very strange how it happened, and the whole chapter is devoted to dissolve this this mystery. So how was it possible at the time when all Lvivians knew about the roots, the origin of Mykhailo Rudnitsky? And even some of them denounced him to Germans. How it happened that he survived, and not only survived, he worked, and he also helped to rescue, to provide some Jews with false documents. And the last chapter is devoted to the artist who was not only an artist but also collector of Ukrainian avant-garde, and her name is Yaroslava Muzyka. She not only survived the war, but she tried to help people during this this period, and it was by coincidence that she met my grandmother, and they joined they join their attempts. My grandmother was responsible for providing food, and she was responsible for providing some medicine to ghetto and to both Muzika friends and my grandmother friends who were imprisoned in ghetto. After World War II, after liberation, she tried also to collect art left by other her friends, Ukrainian painters and other, of course, also of Jewish origin painters. And at the same time, she tried to help to contact between Ukrainian underground movement and Soviet administration. And it was for her a trap. She was arrested, and she was sentenced to 25-year camps. She was already 60 at that time. Only thanks to Stalin's death and the sterilization process, she was
released.
So it is a short trip around the book, and as I wanted to emphasize that most of these documents, most of these personal narratives are were untold, and I tried to show them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's. So we have about 15 to 20 minutes for some questions, and afterwards about 15 minutes for some book signing and also for a little bit of a personal communication. And so I would like to open the floor to questions. So please, short questions, one at a time, and so that we can include as many questions as possible. Anyone?
No questions?
Okay, maybe let me start first to warm everyone up a little bit. So you mentioned in the beginning and also concluding your talk, you know, the kind of the issue of sources and of narratives. And so I wanted to ask you maybe to go deeper into that and to tell us more about some of the sources that you uncovered, as well as new information. Because in the introduction to your book, you mentioned that you did not expect, in fact, to kind of make any major discoveries, right?
Mm-hmm.
Your approach to it was that most of the information was already uncovered, and so you just wanted to kind of weave it into a narrative.
Mm-hmm.
However, as it turned out, that was not exactly the case. So if you would like to go into that, that would be, I think, very interesting.
There are no new facts. I mean, the main facts are well known, and the main data. I mean, the amount of people sentenced, amount of people who were killed and deported, and it is obvious, and we know the dates, we know the data, we know more or less the main events, the most painful events. So why to tell the story again? Because in my opinion, it was untold story. Not in the meaning that it was just unknown, but untold. But other way of the other point of view of at this issues, and as I told, my aim was to try to combine different narratives. When I present the main protagonist, I show him a mirror of other testimonies, of other documents, how he was perceived by others, how they treated them, how she or he survived, what was the price. And it is, you know, it's it seems to me that it is obvious to compare different documents when we are tracing the story. It is obvious for a historian that you have to be very critical to your sources. But no one tried to compare Ukrainian and Polish points of view at the same person, at the same events, and how it is different, how it is similar, how people, how friends became enemies, and how very distant friends or even people who were alien each other, how they became to cooperate to save someone alive. So it is not a problem of national roots. Mm-hmm. It is problem of attitude of this exactly person.
Thank you for this presentation and thank you for the book. It's really, really very, very important and very well researched and written book. Very original one. Very deep in terms of thought and in terms of research that went into it. You have seven chapters and there are seven characters there, and maybe oversimplifying, at the end of the day they're all nice people. You kind of want to relate to their stories, and there are different trajectories. Were there other candidates to get into your book, but people and stories that were rejected? And I wonder, again, you started the book probably not knowing that there will be seven characters and seven chapters. So who were those candidates and why they didn't make it into the book?
Thank you for such question. And I have really many candidates, and I hoped that I will find enough sources for this. I just would like to mention two or three of them, maybe three, because two who come to my mind are Emil Sommerstein and Henrik Hescheles. Henrik Hescheles was editor-in-chief of newspaper Hvila. It was Zionist newspaper, a very famous Lviv newspaper. And he was arrested when he tried to return to Lviv, because he escaped at the mid of September from Lviv, and when he tried to return, he was captured on the Soviet border and arrested and interrogated. And I hope that these documents, these interrogation documents, would help me to tell this story, because also this story was untold. he was murdered in the end of June or the first days of July in the Lviv prison during pogrom. And it was just a few months after he was released from the Soviet prison. So this case would be very interesting for me because Henry Hescheles was very well known and person in Lviv, very close to a famous Ukrainian critic Mykhailo Rudnitsky, and on the other side with a very well-known Polish writer Stanislaw Vincenz. But not only with them, but it was a really important figure in view. But I didn't find other sources. It was just only this. And I could not base my chapter on the base of NKVD interrogations. It is not reliable source. So of course I can draw from this source just things which I already know, the date of birth, his connections, but not more. And that's why I decided not to describe his story. And the other person was Emil Sommerstein, who was a Polish parliament deputy, very well recognized lawyer. A leftist, but not communist. He was arrested by Soviets as a member of Polish parliament, accused in being Polish nationalist and serving to Polish lords. Of course, it is also in
quotation marks.
And then sent to Gulag, and he wasn't released from Gulag until 1944, when a new communist government was established, and then they washed Sommerstein and sent to Polish government, and he served for 2 years as head of Jewish, it wasn't ministry, but Jewish department for helping for
survivors.
Thank you. And then he went to US for a congress, and he survived a stroke, and he was still alive in 1956. However, he never told the story, and I could not find his more documents than this from NKVD archives. So that's why I couldn't tell the story. And I could name other Polish and Ukrainian-born persons who I wish I didn't this.
But if I can ask, a person had to be a victim to a degree to get into your book, one way or another, or you were considering also quote-unquote perpetrators?
There is only one example. with this Irena Yaroslavich and this Anders group, but it is not on. They are not heroes, actually. They are participating in this establishing the Soviet rules. I didn't want to devote much attention to perpetrators, but they are in these books. They are present, but they don't play the main role, because I wanted to tell the story not only about persecutions, but also the story of rescuing people, and I felt that it is very important, and that it is not only defined by his or her nationality.
I was very impressed by your powerful text when I read it in Ukrainian translation. I'm afraid I still need some time to process it. Maybe my question, which is partly related to what Professor he asked, reveals my maybe misunderstanding of some key points. But I would say the book is about rather insiders or outsiders who became insiders. And if so, would you argue that the urban elite of Lviv or Lviv was able to foster common language and some kind of common understanding and to overcome the radicalization of ethnic conflict, which was evident before the Second World War? In other words, whether all the atrocities, mass killings, were imported into the city and not rooted in its kind of domestic conflict, as some scholars would argue, and some scholars would disagree with this point. So what would you comment on the ability of this particular complicated city to overcome totalitarian challenges of the 20th century?
It is my approach not to be on the one side or on the other side. I can understand why we have to see just a half empty glass, or one person will see half empty and other will see half full. It's not my my approach. I'm not not a, a scholar who see only black or only white side. So answering your question about was it rooted with violence in the city or not? Of course, the potential was. But only the extreme mass violence released this potential. So, and we cannot say that just usual Lvivians became in a mass scale perpetrators. Not at all.
One more question, and then we'll have to.
Mm-hmm.
All right. In that case, Serhi, you get the last question.
Well, again, it's probably the most simple, but also maybe difficult question. The title. Courage and fear, it is very striking. And how did you arrive to that title, and how central it is really to the story and to the argument that you are telling?
It's very central. For each story, it is very central, and we cannot separate courage and fear. Fear, it is everyone in such circumstances feels fear. But we cannot see courage without fear. So it is not a philosophical question, it is rather a psychological question. And it is present in not only in every chapter. It is you can see it in every story I am telling in this book. So it's not about hesitating. It is about the path, and when you decided to go this path, it's not it doesn't mean that you are a hero, because you could became non-very heroic person at the same time on the other day. So it is everyday decision.
All right. Lubko. All right, Lubko, you get the last question, but please.
Mine is very short and very specific. There are scattered references in your book to the Ulam family.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam Ulam, as you yourself say, has a very close connection to this university. He was the director of the then Russian Research Center and a close, actually, colleague of a number of us here.
And he was also on the board of
the
Ukrainian
Research Institute.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, by the way, his suggestion to invite Robert Conquest to do the book on the Holodomor. So, but I'm actually thinking of the relatives who stayed behind in Lviv, because you mentioned mostly Adam Ulam and more his brother, the mathematician Stanislav. But the story of the family that remained behind, and especially their sister and her baby, is much more dramatic and quite tragic. So I'm wondering whether there is material on specifically the Ulam family that, you know, could be researched further for those of us who may be interested in the family history of that
mm-hmm.
particular.
Thank you. I could not answer your question, because it demands deep research to find exact family story and to trace it, and especially during World War II, this tragic story. It is extremely hard to answer whether it is possible or not. So, sorry, I can't answer.
Yeah. I thought maybe you had access to materials which
no,
you simply
no.
did not develop.
I have many such questions
yeah.
about very different persons and families, and my answer is as usual. You have to go to archive and you have to look.
All right. Let us conclude this presentation, and I would like to read a little bit from the introduction that I think sums up some of the main thrust of this book. This book draws on archival and printed sources to trace the relationships between select Polish, Ukrainian, and Jewish intellectuals during World War II. The relationships are described not from the perspective of ethnic communities, but from individual points of view. A microfocus helps recalibrate our take on this history. The customary, mutually exclusive national narratives recede, making room for a more universal perspective of humanity. The history, in Courage and Fear, aims to escape pathos and bias and to cross-examine historical verdicts so often mandated by ethnic loyalties. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for
Thank
coming.
You.
You have the opportunity to buy the book and get it signed by the author, as well as some of the select recent publications by the Ukrainian Research Institute. And I welcome you to take this opportunity. We have about 11 minutes before we have to depart. So please make use of your time. Thank you again.